Hello, friends. This is Austin Suter, and before we get into today's episode, I wanted to let you know about some of the articles we have going on at our website right now. I've just written a piece about why we should quit using the term woke if we mean it as an insult. We also have an in-depth book response to Shai Linne's new book, The New Reformation. Speaking of that book, I interviewed Shai about it in the episode you're about to hear, but I did so before the book came out. So if you hear us talking about it being forthcoming, know that the book is out now and you should get it immediately. Grace and peace. Grace and peace, you're listening to United We Pray. Taking racial struggles to the throne of grace, United We Pray is a ministry devoted to prayer about racial strife, especially between Christians. We want to help Christians think better about race in a way that is biblical and helpful, clear and hopeful. You can learn more about our work at uwepray.com. That's uweprayy.com, where you can find articles, old episodes, and more. I'm Austin Suter. I'm one of the co-hosts. Normally, I would be joined by Isaac Adams, but today we have a special guest. Our brother Shai Linne is joining us. How are you, Shai?
I'm doing good, Austin. Thanks for having me, bro.
Absolutely. Readers and listeners will know Shai for his music, for his work at Lamp Mode, as writing at places like Gospel Coalition. We wanted to have him on to talk about his forthcoming book, The New Reformation. And just by way of personal introduction, you've probably got friends whose impact in your life matches the amount of time you spent with them. Like if you have friends with whom you spend a bunch of time, it makes sense that they would impact your life. If you are as blessed as I am, you will also have friends who, though you haven't spent a bunch of time with them, God has still used them to bless and change your life. And for me, Shai is very much that person. He has helped me think in categories that are foreign to me, and he's really helped me on issues of unity and diversity. And honestly, brother, I don't think it's a stretch to say you've changed my life and how you've helped me think through those things. So just publicly wanted to say thank you for your investment.
Wow. Praise the Lord, brother. And it's been good to get to know you over the years and see the Lord at work in your life, brother.
Well, thank you for that. And thank you also for this excellent new book you've written, The New Reformation. When does it come out?
May 18th.
May 18th. Okay, well, we will link to the pre-order in the show notes. We've already promoted that on social media. Brother, why did you want to write this book?
Well, this book has been in the making for years at this point. So one of the things that I say in the book is that the purpose of it is twofold, that it's the unity of the church and the church's witness to the world. So those are two priorities that we see in the high priestly prayer of our Lord in John 17. So in John 17, in 17:21, right? He prays that the church, that we may all be one, and for the purpose so that the world may believe that the Father has sent the Son. And so for me, with all of the polarization that we see surrounding this topic, my concern has been what I see as errors on both sides of the debate. So I've basically been looking for a third way that recognizes the virtues of both sides and is also willing to critique both sides. And so this book is birthed out of something that I've longed to see in these discussions, which is basically voices that are biblical, that are humble, and that are unifying. And those kinds of voices, in my experience, at least as I've surveyed the landscape, those voices have been few and far between. And I don't know that I've achieved that with this book, but that was the desire.
Well, brother, I think you've done a fantastic job. And I think readers will appreciate your consistency, which has marked your entire ministry. And I think that really comes through in the book in just how you're not given to tribalism. You're just consistent in applying biblical truth to these problems as you see them. So thank you for that. You mentioned early on in your book how oftentimes our perspective on ethnic unity is shaped by our experience. And that is how Christians who have the same Bible and have, have read a lot of the same books will land in very different conclusions on ethnic unity and what needs to happen in the church. And I think you very helpfully shared your own experience in ways that was really vulnerable and honest and quite frankly, hard to read at times. What did you want readers to take away from your experience?
Yeah, so in the first three chapters of the book, so the book is broken up into four parts, three chapters each. So part one is my story. And in those three chapters, I'm basically just sharing about my life growing up and my conversion and just highlighting the providence of God along the way. And the reason why I began with those three chapters is it's a way for the reader to get to know me more. And so my hope is that the reader will see the hand of God, not only in my life, but in the lives of others from the Christian hip hop community, and just how he in his providence used the truth set to hip hop to do some really great things in terms of cross-cultural ministry and partnerships. And in those chapters, they also, they set the stage for the events, the cultural events that revealed that the ethnic divide was greater than many people had realized at first. And so, my inclusion of those chapters is in large part, you know, so one of the things I think is missing in these discussions oftentimes is empathy. And empathy is very important for any kind of mutual understanding. And, you know, there's a saying that, you know, empathy is birthed from proximity, so that the closer you are in proximity to a person, the greater the potential for empathy will be there. And as one writing a book, you know, it's very personal in terms of people kind of spending time with the author. And so I'm hoping that kind of proximity will produce some empathy in those who read.
Well, I could definitely see it doing that. And folks who are familiar with your work who might not be in relationship with a lot of people who grew up and had the same experiences that you did, I think this goes a long way toward developing that kind of empathy. So great job on that. You talk a lot about the role of Reformed theology in shaping your own thinking and how the church thinks about this. And then you bring in something called the low-end theory. This is something you came up with to explain how Reformed theology affects discussions on ethnic unity and how it's been applied by different people. Can you explain what you came up with?
Yeah, so the low-end theory, so it's a double entendre because the low-end theory is actually the title of a popular album, hip-hop album.
Tribe Called Quest, man.
Yeah, classic early 90s hip-hop album. In one of the chapters, I go back to the time of the Protestant Reformation, and often one of the things that, and I didn't mention this in the first question that you asked, but it's important. So one of the things that I've personally been grappling with is trying to understand, is there something in particular about Reformed theology and those who hold to it, those who have held to it historically, that produces blind spots when it comes to the area of ethnic injustice? And that was a very serious personal question for me, because I was just trying to grapple with and understand how do we understand the oftentimes the complicitness with the world and its kind of race-based atrocities throughout the centuries. So in one of the chapters, I go back to the Protestant Reformation and just kind of look at what it was all about and what was going on there. And one of the things that I discovered as I was researching was that it was really the invention of the printing press that helped to propel the spread of the Reformation throughout Europe. But one of the things that's important to note is that back then the literacy rates were really low. And so historians estimate that it was less than 10% of the European population that was literate at the time that the Reformation began. And so at that time, literacy, it was actually tied to class. So if you were going to be literate back then, more than likely, the thing that would determine that would be wealth and access to education. And so in other words, the people who were poor or on the quote unquote low end of society, those people were at a disadvantage when it came to interacting with both the Bible and the religious writings that were being spread throughout the culture at the time. And so I talk about this low end theory, and it's really it's questions that I raise. So I'm not necessarily coming to definitive conclusions, but I'm raising questions like, could it be that because of the literacy issue, could it be that Reformed theology as we know it was something that for many centuries was primarily embraced and articulated by wealthy and powerful Christians? So even just considering the fact that, you know, in America, you think about the American descendants of the Reformation, where slavery had a chokehold on the culture in America. Slaves were not allowed to be taught to. It was illegal for a slave to learn how to read. And so you have this huge group of people who the marginalized and the poor who are being left out of the major discussions and formulations of the doctrine in Reformed theology. And I make an allusion to, there's a book called From Every People in Every Nation, A Biblical Theology of Race by J. Daniel Hayes. And what he points out in that book is that when you look at the major systematic theologies over the last 100 years in America, it's striking how little there is to say about the topic of race and racism. You know, when you look simultaneously at what was going on in the culture at the time, it was a huge issue when it came to the unity of the church and when it came to anthropology. Those were major questions that were being asked at the time, and yet you see so little about it in the major theological works. And
it's not like they're silent on other sins.
That's right. That's right. Absolutely. Absolutely. And so then the question, well, why? Why is that? I think there are a number of things that could be pointed to, but I think really what it comes down to is a capitulation to the world and the way that the world was refusing to deal justly in the area of ethnic injustice.
I think that's really good, and I appreciate how you don't draw definitive conclusions, but you sort of get the conversation started, because there's any number of ways Christians could take that, and I hope they do. Mm-hmm. You move from that onto racism and how the world uses the term racism and how it applies the charge, and you say that the world's framework for racism is at once too small and too large. Can you explain what you mean by that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so one of the arguments that I make in the book is for Christians as we engage with this conversation that it's more biblical. We want to use biblical terminology. We want to use phrases that have a biblical basis as we discuss this. And it's one of those things that I know that we're used to talking about it in a certain way, but if we're going to make headway in this discussion, language is important. How defining our terms is important. How we talk about things is really important. And so, one of the arguments that I make is that biblically, race as we know it is a non-category. That the proper biblical term is actually ethnicity, and that usually when we say racism today, we're actually talking about ethnicity. But one of the things that I mentioned is that, yeah, there's a number of problems with the term racism. So race not being a biblical category. And when I say that, I'm not saying that racism doesn't exist. I'm just saying that when we talk about it, we can just be more biblical in how we discuss it. But that term is loaded with unbiblical assumptions. And the term, as we commonly use it, it's so broad that it can say too little and too much at the same time. So the example I give in the book is that when many people hear the term racism, they think KKK and Dylann Roof, the white nationalist, right? Who, right? And you know, so in that understanding of it, racism would be conscious hatred towards a group of people because of their quote unquote race that would lead to violence towards them. So, it's basically individual animosity. But then if, you know, when we kind of get more subtle with it, there's other things that people mean when they speak about racism. So it could refer to discriminatory practices in businesses. It could refer to implicit bias. It could refer to negative stereotypes of groups of people. And that's just a few of the ways that it's used. And so the problem with that is that if you have the spectrum of things that could be included under the umbrella of racism, and then that term racist or race or racism is used, the question becomes, well, where on the spectrum are we talking about? Right. So, is a person who holds to some negative stereotypes about a group of people, is that the same as the KKK?
Right.
You see what I'm saying?
There's no room for nuance.
Exactly. Exactly. And so if as Christians, we're going to address sin, especially in other believers, then it's important that we address it specifically and with biblical categories. And so what I propose in the book is to talk about particular kinds of ethnic sins that basically kind of drill down and use more nuanced and biblical language to talk about some of the things that are meant by using the term racism.
I think that's great. A favorite quote of mine on this is from an old confession of faith, which says it's the duty of Christians to repent of particular sins particularly.
Mm.
And I think you provide a really good framework for that. And I appreciate that you don't just rush to advice.
Mm.
You spend probably, I guess, in typical Pauline fashion, you spend the first 2/3 of the book on theology and then, you know, the last little bit on, you know, application.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was really well done. And I wanted to close by thinking about the applications you provide, which is it all seems really like normal Christian stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But you're applying it a lot more specifically than just sort of the general approach of, you know, preach the gospel and racism will go away. Ethnic mm-hmm. disharmony will go away. Can you explain your approach a little bit? Am I summarizing it correctly?
Yeah, I think so. That really gets to the point of the title of the book, the New Reformation. So the argument that I'm making is not that we need to come up with some kind of new framework or, you know, this kind of brand new thing, but rather let's go back to the old thing, like the thing that is tried and true and trusted. The thing that we celebrate when we think about the Protestant Reformation, the five solas. You know, we're saved by God's grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, to the glory of God alone, based on the scripture alone. The things like the doctrine of justification and the doctrine of the union of the believer with Christ. We're not going to throw those things away. Like those are ancient landmarks that should not be moved. But what we're going to do is, how can we look at those things and apply them specifically in these areas? I'm glad you just mentioned like that whole phrase, kind of just preach the gospel. I understand when brothers and sisters say that. I get what they're aiming for, but the problem there is that we don't use that kind of reductionistic language with other sins, right?
No.
Right. So, you know, when it comes to things like lust and anger, stealing. So, like, we don't say just preach the gospel and anger will go away. Well, no, you preach against those things. Discipleship is necessary to kind of work through those things. The gospel is the power of God to enable believers to not only be saved from sin, but then to continually turn from sin as Christians. And that's going to be necessary in every area of our lives, including the realm of ethnicity, ethnic sin. Um, so, So yeah, it's not just preach the gospel. It's the gospel must not be lost. So we can't ignore the gospel. We have to preach the gospel, but we need to apply the gospel in particular areas. And really, when it comes to these discussions, you know, we think about kind of normal Christian virtues. It's the things that we are exhorted to in the Bible. So in passages like 1 Peter 3:8, where we're told to have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Things like that, which are crucial when it comes to having these discussions surrounding very volatile topics. One of my primary concerns is not only the particular issues themselves, but how we as believers are interacting with each other concerning these issues.
And those normal Christian virtues, as we've called them, they might seem less exciting to those of us who are involved in these conversations. Like we might want something new and something shiny, but brother, like if Christians are humble and united in mind and are working towards these things, that is hugely countercultural. Both inside the church and outside of it. It is a new thing in one sense. And so I just really appreciated your clarity on that.
Amen, brother.
Well, Shai, anything else you want to talk about? I would love for us to close in prayer just as we think about these things and apply them to the church. Anything I missed?
I guess one thing that I'll say is I think one of the challenges of both social media and the pandemic is that over the last year or so, we've just become much more isolated. And when we think about what the Bible calls us to, I'm a firm believer that these issues are not going to be resolved with a tweet or
no.
a Facebook post. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So I really want to stress the importance of the local church. I want to stress the importance of relationships, cross-cultural relationships, depending on your particular context and where you are, because we're going to make headway in these discussions over the dinner table, and as we're in each other's lives and able to sharpen each other through conversation with open Bibles, but actually sharing our lives with each other in such a way that I can feel comfortable that the brother or sister that I'm speaking to, who may even be challenging me on some of these particular issues, is someone who knows me, who loves me, and who has my best interest in mind, and vice versa, and that's very important as we seek to strive for unity, that we're actually in each other's lives in such a way that we can walk that out.
Amen. And as it's often said, it's hard to hate somebody when you're praying for them and when you're in fellowship with them. So
Amen.
I agree
Amen.
With you that that's the way forward. Well, brother, if you're comfortable with it, why don't I open us in prayer and you can close us and we can just pray for the church in these things and pray that God use this book.
Amen. Let's do it.
Father God, thank you for my brother. Thank you for making him. Thank you for saving him in the marked way you did. Thank you for all the ways you've used him over the years. Thank you for this book. And Lord, we don't trust in the works of men. We know that unless you build the house, labor's work in vain. And so, Lord, we just pray for fruit from this book, that it would be widely read, that it would be a helpful tool for folks as they have these conversations. And Lord, we just pray for unity in your churches, in your church worldwide. Lord, we pray that believers would not demonize, that we would not apply false motives, that we would not subdivide on any of the categories that the world tempts us to divide over, but we would be unified as you prayed for in John 17. Lord, we just pray that unity would be a blessing to us in our churches, and that it would commend the gospel, and ultimately, Lord, in all things, that it would glorify you.
Mm.
So we pray for that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen. And Father, we praise your holy name. We praise you that you are good and your steadfast love endures forever. Lord, we thank you for your grace and your kindness. We thank you that you are rich in mercy. We thank you that because of the great love with which you loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses. Lord, you made us alive together with Christ. And Father, we thank you that the Lord Jesus has brought those who were once far off, that he's brought us near by the blood of Christ, that he's broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility. We thank you for his death on the cross and his glorious resurrection. And Lord, we thank you that at the cross, the Lord Jesus purchased our unity. And Lord, we pray that you would help us as your people to walk in that. Help us to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which we've been called. Lord, I pray that as we discuss these things in our particular context, Lord, that the discussions will be characterized by humility, by gentleness, by patience, and by bearing with one another in love. Lord, help us as your people to be eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Lord, we need you, and we can't do anything apart from you. And so we look to you for help. Your word says, blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob. And we pray that you would help us as your people to grow in walking in the unity that Jesus purchased for us at Calvary. And we pray that you would do these things for the glory of your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, brother, thank you so much for the time. Thank you for coming on. And you say May 18th, the book comes out?
May 18th, that's right.
Well, can't recommend it highly enough, and we will link to it all over the place. But, brother, thank you again for this work, for all your work.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Absolutely. So this has been United We Pray. Grace and peace.